The qualities that define an aesthetically pleasant skin are very much universal, and they're very similar to the qualities of what defines healthy skin. Healthy looking skin is defined as one that has no or few imperfections, is not too dry or too oily, has minimally visible pores, and an overall radiant complexion. Many try their best to achieve a healthy skin using expensive skincare products, and this has caused the industry for skincare products to become a multi-billion dollar and thriving business with endless choices for skincare products ranging from face washes to skin serums and cleansers and toners and sunscreens. Sunscreens are pretty important, I do have to say, but everything else, there's a lot of fluff in the skincare industry. But to the dismay of many, buying the most expensive skincare products for your skin and using them regularly and religiously often doesn't give you the desired effect. And this is much so because there are other important factors at play that are responsible for healthy looking skin, such as your genetics and lifestyle choices, which is what we're going to be talking about today. There is a specific group of people who have the most healthy and almost perfect skin, and those are, well, newborns and children who regularly fall under this group. The reason behind their vibrant, flawless skin is because their skin has not been subjected to years of sun damage, hormonal acne, harmful chemicals, mechanical trauma, environmental toxins, so on and so forth. And as people grow older, their skin changes in appearance, developing wrinkles, sunspots, and overall just losing collagen and elastin. But not all people and their skin respond equally to the same adverse agents that we are almost all universally exposed to. And there's a reason for that: skin genetics. It is well known that genes determine skin color, skin thickness, and skin type. The genes actually have a bigger role than this. A study on same-sex twins determined that genetic influence is up to almost 62% of the variation in skin aging, while the rest of the 40 or so percent are attributed to other non-genetic factors. The most important of these non-genetic factors that negatively influence your skin aging are obviously sun exposure and smoking, and I feel like at this point we've spoken about this ad nauseum. Researchers have directly documented the effects of both smoking and sun exposure on skin morphology and deterioration with age, and the too long didn't read of it is that you want to minimize both sun exposure and obviously your exposure to smoking. Sex and ethnicity both provide some obvious evidence of genetic influence on skin as well, where Asian skin tends to wrinkle at an older age by almost 10 years in comparison to European Caucasian skin, as per a study by Makra Antonaki and colleagues. But the most obvious difference attributed to genetic variability is the patterns of skin pigmentation, which can vary based on a person's ethnicity. African Americans have high levels of skin pigmentation, which does have a protective effect from skin damage as a result of sun exposure, and Robertson et al. Discovered that sun-exposed areas and unexposed areas of skin showed minimal difference in skin structure and aging-related changes in African Americans, meaning that the melanin in the skin does have some protective effect, but again, as we've covered in our previous videos on sun exposure and skin tone, it's more of a SPF 15 that you naturally get, but that's not good enough, so you really need to still put on sunscreen. This finding was in stark contrast with the response of Caucasian skin to sun exposure, where Caucasians showed significant differences in skin elasticity and sun-induced damage when comparing sun-exposed sites to unexposed sites. North European skin tones of Caucasians fall under skin type 1 generally, as per the Fitzpatrick classification. That is to say that when exposed to sunlight, the skin burns rather than tans, and therefore not only are they more prone to sun damage, but also skin cancer, as they lack the protective benefits of melanin against UV rays. The presence or absence of chromosome Y is what determines sex. Apart from sexual characteristics, the genetic difference also has a direct influence on skin response to oxidative stress from sun exposure. Oblong et al. Discovered that the male skin is far more prone to sun damage from UV-induced skin damage and other environmental insults. Masoudi et al. Also found differences in DNA damage, oxidative stress, and overall skin damage between males and females, with men responding much more adversely to environmental stresses than women. Researchers are now shifting their focus on the correlation between gene mutations and common skin disorders such as skin atrophy, alopecia, telangiectasia, sclerosis, and skin malignancies. The study found the changes in gene expression and mutation were similar in patients with Werner syndrome and normal skin aging. This corresponds with the assumption that variations and mutations in genes determine skin aging and responses to oxidative stress. Not everyone responds to the sun damage and the environmental factors in the same way. Furthermore, mutations in genes that regulate growth hormone and pituitary hormones can increase the likelihood of early skin aging, such as wrinkle formation and skin dehydration. Naval et al. Identified 13 single nucleotide polymorphisms in genes that code for proteins important in determining one's skin response to oxidative stress, and found that these change with aging in regards to skin elasticity and skin hydration. As per their findings, a cluster A of gene variants showed increased susceptibility to oxidative stress owing to weak versions of antioxidant genes. On the other hand, cluster 10 demonstrated good genetic activity against oxidative stress to skin. The study findings implicate that those belonging to cluster A require more concentrations of antioxidants in their cosmetic products as compared to cluster 10. This suggestion by the researchers was aimed not just to enhance protection for cluster 8, but also to limit the damage that excess antioxidants may have on cluster 10 genetic types. Genomic analysis can be a useful tool to characterize human skin and the needs for anti-aging products. In the future, there could be a service that takes your genetic data and caters your skincare products most accurately to how your skin is expected to respond to environmental stresses. As genomic typing services become more affordable and easily available, analyzing genes to develop individualized skincare plans could be a very much viable option in the future. Genetic variations are responsible for the unique characteristics of each individual, and they may be an important determining factor in the future for all clinical and pharmacological interventions. This idea is consistent with the concept of providing treatment to the person instead of to the particular condition, which is currently gaining a lot of recognition as a much more effective way to approach patients and medical healthcare in the medical field. By understanding the morphology and underlying biology of an individual's skin, and then identifying the genes that are representative of the skin's aging process, designing novel strategies to modulate skin aging can be not only effective and appropriate, but very much a reality in the next decade or so. So to summarize everything I've spoken about in this video, everyone is exposed to harmful agents in the environment, from sun damage to smoking to pollutants. Everyone, almost universally, we're all exposed to it, but not everybody responds to it in the same way. Some people have genetic coding that helps them deal with oxidative stress much more freely and readily than those who are lacking the antioxidant genes. What this means is that given two people of different genetic makeup but same environmental stimulus, they will age differently and one will age better than the other, as their skin can retain collagen and elastin much longer than the other person can just due to their genetic makeup. There are also other factors in your genetic makeup like your skin color, and we've explained that having higher melanin does protect your skin to a degree from the sun damage, but again, that's a genetic factor. There's also skin thickness, and we haven't covered that directly, but that's also another important consideration. And there's also skin hydration, dryness, skin turgor, and pull. There's so many other factors to consider. Hopefully, following this video, you don't stress yourself out too much in worrying about your genetic makeup for skincare. The general recommendations are still to wear sunscreen, practice responsible sun exposure, which means that if you do wish to tan, you understand the limits of what your skin can take and you avoid over tanning, or even if you can, avoid tanning altogether. It's not a very healthy practice. There are also more minor things you can do, like avoid taking very hot showers, which dries out your skin. Wear moisturizers right after you shower when you wake up in the morning, and wear that with your sunscreen daily, almost consistently, and obviously cleanse your skin. So general routine and maintenance tips. You don't need special $2,000 creams, because as we're going to talk in another video, when it comes to skincare, prevention easily outweighs your treatment options, and ideally you want to start your skincare protection and prevention routine in your early 20s.